So we continue with the chapter that we had started yesterday, that is the rat trap. As we have discussed right now, that how the rat trap maker, as he was walking along the roads alone, thoughts came to his mind. And one thought which he found very interesting was that the world is a rat trap. And yes, so everyone is there circling that bait. Everyone is there attracted to the material goods and riches which are here. And we all, either we have fallen into the trap or we're going to get caught in it, right? So here when we read this chapter, the underlying theme here is, as we had discussed yesterday, that it reads like a fairy tale. And it's about that how kindness and goodness can bring about a change. So the peddler was alone, and at night he sought shelter at a house, and generally he never got a good response, you know. So people were there quite annoyed and they were not very happy to see him. But that evening, to his surprise, he not only got shelter, but he found a very hospitable host who fed him, right? And yes, told him everything about his life and about that how he used to work at the ironworks factory before, and now he's an old man. He can't work on the land, and now he has a cow. He sells the milk, and so he earns enough to keep himself, you know, like what, alive and to take care of himself. So he's very happy with his life at the moment. But yes, there is loneliness in his life. He's not got anyone to talk to. He's without wife and children. And so when he sees this peddler at his doorstep, so he welcomes him inside. He's very hospitable and he's quite talkative. So not only gives him food, he gives him tobacco and to smoke here. And they play this game of Mayolus, the card game, right? The old man, yes, so he's told him that how he has a cow and he sells the milk and he's able to earn enough. And in fact, he also shows him the 30 kroners that he has earned. We don't go around showing our savings and our things to somebody or to a stranger who comes to our house. But it was because of the loneliness that this man just got up and showed that his earnings. And this is what I have here. The stranger must have seemed incredulous, for the old man got up. He thought that this man is not believing me. I'm just telling lies, according to him. So he went to the window. He took down a leather pouch, which hung on a nail in the very window frame, and picked out three wrinkled 10 kroner bills. He's saying this man does not believe me. So he went to the window, and in that pouch, he had kept his money. See, he's least bothered there, and he's just hung his money in the window frame. That no one comes over here, no one is going to take that money away. These he held up before the eyes of his guest, nodding knowingly. The guest is there quite amazed to see 30 kroners. This man has never seen so much of money, right? And then stuffed them back into the pouch. The next day, both men got up in good season. So he's taken shelter at this person's house. And the next morning, yes, the old man has to go back to work. He has to take care of his cow. And it's very rude, you know, like there, that his host has got up and he has gone to work. So he's just lying around. So he also gets up. The crofter was in a hurry to milk his cow. And the other man probably thought he should not stay in bed when the head of the house had gotten up. It's manners, decency. They left the cottage at the same time. The crofter locked the door and put the key in his pocket. The man with the rat trap said goodbye and thank you, and thereupon each went his own way. Right, so they were both of them, they parted their ways. He said thank you for the hospitality, for the kindness. But half an hour later, the rat trap peddler stood again before the door. He did not try to get in, however. He only went up to the window, smashed a pane, stuck in his hand, and got hold of the pouch with the 30 kroner. He took the money and thrust it into his own pocket. Then he hung the leather pouch very carefully back in its place and went away. So what did he do? they parted ways. The crofter has gone to work. He has to take care of his cow and he's in a hurry. So the peddler also leaves the house. But after some time, he comes back again, stands in front of the window, and he smashes the pane and he takes away the pouch. What was there in the pouch? Yes. What was there in the pouch? 30 kroners. Yes. And of course here, now the peddler was there comparing the world with the rat trap. And he's very happy that he's away from all this kind of temptation. But the moment he saw money in front of him, he also got tempted. He's fallen into the trap, right? He could have walked away, but he came back, a very conscious decision that he took. He came back, he broke the pane, and he stole the money, right? And you think it was the right thing to do? The old man had so much of faith in him, so much confidence in him. And he was there, you know, like telling him about his money, about his life. And he just went away without any second thought. He stole his money, right? So the crofter's, you know, like confidence that he had in him. The crofter is a farmer. Okay, what's a crofter? Crofter is a farmer, a small, you know, say farmer. And earlier, this man used to work for the iron works, right over there, Ramjo Iron Works. But now, because he's old, now he has the cow and he takes care of the cow. And the cow, yes, he sells the milk and he's able to lead a comfortable life, right? So when we started reading this chapter, we know that this story is set in Sweden. So the backdrop, the setting is of that place. So we do come across here, like they're talking about mining, which is quite, you know, like common over there, right? And then the game of cards that he's playing, Mjolnir, right? So it's a card game over there, just like we have popular card games in our country, indoor games, right? So all card games, most of them are indoor, of course. Then, yes, so he's talking about the ironworks. Right, so mining there, right, naturally. So when you extract the ore, it has to be taken to be mined also. Right, so that is the setting, farming, all this, which is a part of the economy of that country, right? Yes. Now, so what has the crofter done? He has stolen the money. As he walked along with the money in his pocket, he felt quite pleased with his smartness. He's really happy. Oh my God, I'm so clever. I went and stole that money. He realized, of course, that at first he dared not continue on the public highway, but must turn off the road into the woods. Why did he do this? Earlier, the peddler used to walk lonely, alone, slowly on the highways, right? He used to walk very slowly over there, and as night fell, looking for shelter, he had these thoughts which came to his mind, comparing the world with a rat trap. But as soon as he laid his hands on the 30 kroner, instead of walking on the road, he's changed his mind now. He's not going to be on the road. Why do you think he's changed that? Why doesn't he want to be on the road? Yes? Anyone? Because he has stolen the money. And because he's stolen the money, he is afraid that, yes, he would be caught for it. Because he has stolen the money from someone, there are chances that because he has money, someone can steal that money from him also. So in the real sense, what has happened to the crofter? He has fallen into the rat trap. Earlier, he was living a life without any worries and fears or tensions or problems. But the moment he stole those 30 kroners, his life changed. So money does that to you. You're right. Of course, here you do what you want to earn more and more, and whatever you have, you want to take care of that, isn't it? Right. So here, yes, this man now, he could not walk on the public highway. And he went off the road into the woods. During the first hours, this caused him no difficulty. So he was quite energetic and he kept on walking. But later in the day, it became worse as he's going deeper and deeper into the denser forest there. It was a big and confusing forest which he had gotten into. He tried to be sure to walk in a definite direction, But the paths twisted back and forth so strangely. So naturally in the forest, there's no proper track which you can follow. So it's very easy to get lost. So he's just walking over there, this big forest, confusing forest, and he has got lost. He tried to be sure to walk in a definite direction, but the paths twisted back and forth so strangely. He walked and walked without coming to the end of the wood. And finally, he realized that he had only been walking around in the same part of the forest. So he walked and walked, and he's not coming to the end of the wood, and he's following a path. But then when he, you know, came out, you know, like he realized, I'm here only. I'm just walking in the same place, right? So he is stuck, does not know the way. He's come off the road into the forest, thinking it'll be easier for him. He'll just cross the forest and go to some other place away from the crofter's house. That was his plan, isn't it? Right? All at once, he recalled his thoughts about the world and the rat trap. So what did he think about the world? That the world is a rat trap, right? And he makes rat traps. And now what has happened to him? Now his own turn had come. He is caught in the rat trap. He had let himself be fooled by a bait and had been caught. So he allowed himself to be fooled. What is the bait? What is the bait? The 30 kroners that were hanging right there in front of him in a pouch in the window pane. And he was there caught in the trap. He stole the money and now he's running away. He's trying to escape with that money, but he's caught in the rat trap. And he thinks this is what it might feel with people who have money. The whole forest with its trunks and branches, its thickets and fallen logs. And he's caught in a dense forest, closed in upon him like an impenetrable prison from which he could never escape. Impenetrable. Right? It's very difficult to get out of that, right? So he cannot come out of the forest, right? So where, what prison is he in now? A prison of his own making. He's fallen into the trap. He went to the forest, does not know the way. He's got lost over there. He's walking around in the same place. And now he feels, I'm never, ever going to come out of this place. I'm going to get lost over here, right? Yes. So just see that how just one decision of his, it's changed his whole life. It was late in December. December, winter months, right? So you have these long nights. Darkness was already descending over the forest. This increased the danger and increased also his gloom and despair. Danger, how will he find his way out? And he's even more sadder. Finally, he saw no way out and sank down on the ground, tired to death. He's been tired of walking around in the forest, trying to find a way to escape, but he's unable to find a way out. And he thinks that I'm going to die over here. I'm so exhausted and tired. Thinking that his last moment had come, but just as he laid his head on the ground, he heard a sound. So he's laid down on the ground and okay, the end is near. I'm not going to come out of this. There's darkness all around and in the night, there was not going to be any hope at all. But as he was lying down, what did he hear? He heard a sound, a hard, regular thumping. There was no doubt as to what that. So what else is there? Apart from farming, we talk about mining there, right? So very common over there. And yes, what was it? The sound of the iron mill. There was no doubt as to what that was. He raised himself. Those are the hammer strokes from an iron mill, he thought. So it was that, yes, the iron ore after the extraction there, it was beaten into the sheets. So that thumping sound, those hammers there. So he's heard that sound. And yes, so he's going to survive. He's going to be alive. And he's very happy that, yes, there is some place nearby. Those are the hammer strokes from an iron mill, he thought. There must be people nearby. He summoned all his strength, got up and staggered in the direction of the sound. Staggered, once again. What is staggered? Walking with difficulty. Yeah, he's already tired, exhausted, and he's just want to reach that place so that he can be safe. So the sound of the iron mill, the beating of the iron gave him hope that there are people around. So once he could find people, yes, he could find a way out of the forest. He would survive. Tranyo Ironworks, which are now closed down, were not so long ago a large plant with smelter, rolling mill, and forge. So it was once a very, you can say, bustling place with activity, but now not so large it was, right? And it had all the things, you know, with the smelter and the rolling mill and the forge, all the processes which there after the extraction of the ore, right? In the summertime, long lines of heavily loaded barges and scows slid down the canal, which led to a large inland lake. And in the wintertime, the roads near the mill were black from all the coal dust, which sifted down from the big charcoal grate. So it was very busy, right? So a lot of activity naturally of the process there of the extraction and then, yes, making that into the sheets. Then transporting it, right? The summertime long lines of heavily loaded barges. So barges are those small ships there, the boats there on the canals, and scows slid down the canal, which led to a large inland lake. So transportation there by the canals there. And so that the material, it was taken from the iron works there, right? And in the winter time, because of the, you know, the furnaces, they're burning. So the smoke coming out, and it seemed everything was there covered with the dust, right? So it was once upon a time a very busy place, but now it is not so much bustling with activity. During one of the long dark evenings, just before Christmas, the master smith and his helper sat in the dark forge near the entrance, waiting for the pig iron, which had been put in the fire to be ready to put on the anvil, right? So it could be beaten with the hammer there, right? And made into those sheets. Every now and then, one of them got up to stir the glowing mass with a long iron bar, returning in a few moments, dripping with perspiration, though, as was the custom. He wore nothing but a long shirt and a pair of wooden shoes, because it is so hot inside factory there, or that iron work there. And yes, so near the furnace, what is there? The ore is being melted and it will be taken out and beaten there with the hammer on the anvil over there, right? So yes, so one of the workers would go there and move with the iron rod and that glowing mass, you know, just keep on turning it around. And then because of the high temperature, right, although it is December month and very harsh winters outside, but here inside it was very hot and very, very sweaty. So even in the winter months, these workers, they were perspiring. All the time, there were many sounds to be heard in the forge. The big bellows groaned and the burning coal cracked. So like naturally, so that air has to be pumped into the furnace. So the bellows there, pumping that air, the burning coal crackling as it is, you know, burning, and that is spitting down and falling. So the sound coming. The fire boy shoveled charcoal into the maw of the furnace, the face, the mouth of the furnace, with a great deal of clatter. So fire has to be kept on burning, right? And what is that boy doing? He's putting more and more charcoal. So sounds are there coming. Outside roared the waterfall, and a sharp north dip whipped the rain against the brick-tiled roof. So outside, see, it's very cold. There's this chilly winter winds. And right, in contrast, inside, it's very warm, right? The furnace there burning, and the sound of the air being blown into that, these huge bellows for pumping that air, and the boy is there shoveling that charcoal, and someone picking up that melted ore, you know, like the pig iron, and putting it on the anvil and beating it with the hammer. So lots of activity happening there, right? Yes. Now, it was probably on account of all this noise that the blacksmith did not notice that a man had opened the gate and entered the forge until he stood close up to the furnace. So who's entered the forge? Who is the man over here who's entered? There's so much of noise happening in the inside the forge, right near the furnace, that they did not notice this man coming inside. Who is it? It was the tramp. It was the peddler. It was that vagabond. It was the rat trap maker, right? Surely it was nothing unusual for poor vagabonds without any shelter for the night to be attracted to the forge by the glow of light. So it was a common sight. People, yes, would come and seek shelter, and especially homeless people. So they would come to seek shelter over here. And so the people working over there did not pay much attention, right? And so what does this man come to do? He has come inside this forge, and because, yes, he heard the sound, he walked towards the sound, and he wanted to save himself and find a way out of the dense forest. The blacksmith glanced only casually and indifferently at the intruder. He looked the way people of his type usually did, with the long beard, dirty, ragged, and with a bunch of rat traps dangling on his chest.